welcome. The big breaking news a few days ago was Fair & Lovely dropping Fair from its name and replacing it with Glow. Now, it was hailed as victory by some and termed as complete hogwash by many others. Remember, this is a brand which for 45 years has shown ads in which women scale higher, achieve more on the basis of their skin color. This is something which was disputed by activists in India for years, because it automatically associated dark skin with shame and disappointment. Now, we can call it reinforcing stereotypes or maybe feeding into insecurities. But the question is, can a cosmetic change in a name help uproot this deeply ingrained bias that the beauty brands have been trying to perpetuate for decades? Now, to discuss that, we have a fairly balanced panel today on Creative Talks. Let me start with KV Sridhar, Global CCO, Nihilant Hyper Collective, and he has made a few Fair & Lovely ads in the past when during his stint with Lintas. So I think a lot of questions are going to come your way today, Pops. Then we have Subhash Kamath, CEO and Managing Partner of BBH India. He's also the Vice Chairman of Advertising Standards Council of India. Then we have Ram Subramaniam, founder and director of Handloom Picture Company. He's also popularly known as the voice of Ram. Ronita Mitra, founder and chief strategist, Brand Eagle Consulting. And lastly, we have Mr. Ramesh Jew Thomas. He's the president and chief knowledge officer of Equator Value Advisory Private Limited. And he has been a pioneer in brand valuation. So a big welcome to everybody. And before we start the discussion, let me say that this will be streamed live on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter. So I bet our panelists will be very happy to take questions on all of these platforms. So let's go back. I want to start with you, Ram. You're an ad filmmaker turned activist. And you know, I remember in 2017, you made this one video which went viral, asking Hindustan Unilever to stop manufacturing Fair & Lovely. Tell me, what were your reasons?
Okay, so I'm an ad filmmaker who turned activist for a while, and then I became an ad filmmaker because I got tired of activism. So one of the reasons I went after Fair & Lovely was the fact that it's very personal to me. So I've seen what the cream does to people, and I was in a house, a basic middle class house from South India, and like every house, we used to also have like a tube of the cream, and I'd used this over a while. And it's only after you reach a certain age, after you are a little more aware, that you figure out how something can damage you. Mm-hmm. Okay, and as an advertising person, I'm aware of the kind of damage we do. I mean, it's mostly benign in most cases, because if you look at it logically, yes, we are catering to insecurities. Every product at some level tells you, you know, this. But I felt that Fair & Lovely crossed the line. It crossed the line, as an Indian, and also a South Indian who's seen what happens. I felt that the line was crossed, which is why I ended up making that film. So all the things that I had to say in it explains why I felt that this cream should go. And to be honest, I'm quite happy that they are looking at this change of name.
Okay. You know, I think during our childhood also, we've seen a lot of these ads screaming from our television screen saying Fair is good. Yeah. And I think we have someone right here on our panel to thank for some of that, Mr. KV Sridhar. Pops, tell me, you made some of these ads during your stint at Lintas. What was it like to be building a brand which literally aimed at generating confidence amongst the Indian women who are largely dusky by telling them that, hey, the solution to all your problems is to turn fairer by using this cream?
First of all, you have to do something for a living, correct? So you have to, you know. There are two aspects to anything in life. One is what is legal, and second is what is ethical. So, you know, a lot of people may have issues about ethics, you know, why Fair & Lovely is called Fair & Lovely, and why it is advertised the way it is advertised. I think in our country, you know, a democratic country, if if we are allowed to manufacture any product, and you should allow them to advertise. If you don't, and explain the benefit of that product to people. If you don't do that, then there is no justice. There is absolutely why, you know. Even liquor and cigarettes, which are harmful, are allowed in this country, you know, to be made and then to be sold. And then a lot of money government also makes, and everybody makes money in the process. So that's the legality of it. You know, legally it is allowed. As far as the product is concerned, Fair and Lovely, historically, you know, technically they promise bring you back your skin color to your original tone. So if whatever is your original tone, because of pollution, because of whatever reasons, it darkens. And then what this cream promises is to allow you to go back and then restore your original complexion. It can't make anybody whiter. You know, suddenly we can't become like Julia Roberts. So that's a misconception. That's what the brand actually does and promises. It started as a cream for pharmaceutical thing, you know, where black patches and different patches for little babies when they have deficiencies, you know, to be used. And then since the product works so well, and then they actually commercialized it. And coming, and that's a scenario. That's a scenario. And then because, you know, all of us at one end, you deal with selling a soap or a shampoo with milk proteins. And then the same evening, you go to JJ Hospital, and then you are chatting up with the warden there, and suddenly you realize that so many infants die because they don't have access to milk, mother's milk. So you have to live with these paradoxes of what you do for a living, and then what kind of world you live in. And it is not so easy that you can have a good night's sleep every day, because there are paradoxes, and then you have to balance them. And then today, I think, you know, the biggest shift which Balki and I did when we were working on that is getting away from marriage rut, and then, you know, bringing women to finding their own talent. Mm-hmm. You know, the if you remember, probably Ram might remember a commercial which we ran in South, you know, especially in Chennai, called Pata Class. So it is a girl, you know, keeps singing, and then the boy does not even see her. He only listens to her song, you know, her voice, and then falls in love with her. So the first step which we took was find your talent, then you are more desirable than color of your skin, because the confidence was very, very low. And then we have built, you know, on that, and then discover your talents and your passions. Then we did that entire Genelia ad of cricket commentary. And then the other, the girl actually takes her father, because father was disappointed that he didn't have a son, so that he could have coffee as many times as he wants. And then the girl actually finds a job, and then he takes her father to a five-star restaurant and buys him a coffee. So gender equality, you know, but the stereotypes, you know, you try to make whatever you have within your limits and within your, because each time when you write a story or a commercial, you have a white paper in front of you. And then no client will ever say that, you know, I want gender, you know, not sensitive stereotype. You know, but and you know, then we like, want to offend people. Correct. So right. In the bargain, you know, it might happen. Yeah.
Having said that, you know, of course, Fair and Lovely was introduced in India because, you know, there was this belief, you know, large belief which every mother has passed down to their daughter, saying that, you know, fair is good. So, but even if it was the actual reflection of the belief in the society, shouldn't a large advertiser like HUL be responsible about it? You know, I'd like to actually just mention the same two ads that you know, brought up. The first one where this man is lamenting about not having a son. and, you know, saying that I wish I had a son to, you know, pay my dues off or whatever. And this daughter overhears it, and then she runs and says, I will be his son. And then she gets his fairness tube and she becomes an air hostess because she turns fair. So this underlining, I think the concept was, you know, be dark and fail, be fair and succeed. I think even for the Genelia ad, even though you spoke about women empowerment and how a woman can, you know, become a commentator, you know, in a male-dominated field, you know, but the fact was it was showing the shade card where there's this dark person and there's this white, fairer person. And you were saying that she became successful because she's fair. I'd actually like to take a vote here. What do you think, Ronita?
So what do I think about the other market?
Do you think as a response, is it responsible on the brand's part, even though it has to sell? Should it keep reinforcing stereotypes like that?
So, you know, the skin color, quite honestly, is synonymous and rooted with a lot of other cultural codes in our society. So I don't think we can just look at skin color in isolation, although it's been the most talked about thanks to so many brands, you know, having appropriated that category. There are a lot of synonymous cultural codings like the caste system, like, you know, the income classes and socioeconomic classes, and what strata of society or work you belong to, or gender, you know, which is something that Box just referred to. So I think we just need to be careful and conscious of the fact that it's not just about looking at skin color at a very superficial level. It is addressing many, many other deep-rooted cultural codes in the country. And as brands, and I would say anybody in a position of power and influence, be it brand, be it media, be it television serials, be it movies, when you're in a position of power and influence, you can either continue to perpetrate these regressive belief systems, or you can be the harbinger of change and actually shape and change consumer opinions. And right. I think what happens is that, and first of all, of course, there is this whole aspect of, you know, brands being responsible, and Pops also mentioned, you know, what is technically right versus what is ethically right. So there is this whole aspect of responsible and brands taking the position, you know, taking a responsible position and not continuing to reinforce these regressive belief systems. If they are actually in the position of power, money, via ad spends, via distribution and everything, to actually change and shape public and consumer opinion. However, I think what happens is that, you know, entities such as these brands, you know, media, movies, have this myopic vision and take a very myopic stance of A, staying on the right side of public opinion and not wanting to rock the boat. And secondly, you know, also the short-term business gains. And, you know, these, and actually, even if you change public opinion in the long term, it will be profitable, you know, because when you have the advertising might, when you have the kind of might that these organizations have, large organizations have, even changing public opinion can turn profitable. However, it is always the short-term pressures of, you know, business gains and shareholder wealth and share prices which end up driving these decisions. So even if, I completely agree that, you know, brands do have a responsibility, and whether, you know, it's about this short-term business gain versus long-term financials, I think Ramesh would be in a better position to comment on it. But to me, it's always this, you know, myopic vision and the short-term pressure.
Well, Ramesh, what would you say?
Okay. I have a strong views, but I think my position on this panel is as a dispassionate left brain character. I think so it may be worthwhile just to examine the numbers, because if you look at it from a value standpoint, the first thing is how valuable is Fair and Lovely to HUL and to the category. Okay. So some quick overview on the numbers. As on date, HUL has about 40 brands, give or take, right? There are only four who are more than 3,000 crores. And Fair and Lovely is one of them at 4,100 crores, right? So it's a big one. Secondly, if you look at the growth and the and profitability, I understand that on the average, as against the average of HUL, the profitability of something like Fair and Lovely is twice the average of HUL. on a base of 39,000 crores. Lastly, 2020 growth for HUL was 1.9%, whereas Fair and Lovely grew at 20%. So if you look at any of the base metrics that we use for a valuation, it is an incredibly valuable brand for HUL. Yeah? It would almost be the flagship if it were more acceptable, so to speak, socially. Right? I mean, and therefore, messing with this because of the way their hand was forced by the BLM campaign would have been a huge decision. It's almost like somebody messing with the iPhone at Apple. You know, it's that big a brand for them at that size. So, is it valuable? Hell yes. Is it important to them? Very much. The other question is, therefore, is this decision likely to, you know, affect the brand? Last week on Friday, the shares fell by 1%.
Okay.
And in 2012, when they changed from white color to pink color, there was a huge pushback from the customer.
Right.
So purely from a value standpoint, from, you know, very dispassionately, is this change good for them? I suspect not.
Okay.
Right. I'll tell you why. Because the premise on which this brand was built was that you are better because you're fairer. Right.
Right.
And if the renaming is going to question that premise, right, then the entire thing begins to fall apart. And why is it risky? Because it's a young people's brand most of all. And therefore, customer acquisition, another very important metric of valuation, is going to be highly risked as a consequence of that. So is it, it's no longer fair, but glow. I can get that from a lot of people. Why do I need to go to Fair and Lovely? And remember, the last thing, Fair and Lovely is 66% of the fairness market. Okay, so it is almost the category by itself. Yeah.
True. So technically you're saying that, you know, the whole point of, you know, if you take away the promise of fairness and the customer was, of course, going to this cream because it was going to give you fair skin, then the category itself might get decimated along with the brand. That's what you're trying to say.
I mean, you can say all you want about Trump, but he's got 88 million followers on Twitter itself. So it's a highly relevant brand. It's a huge brand. It's got a very good growth path. Yeah. The only question is, if the brand has great value, the question is whether the brand has values. That we'll discuss in another segment.
Subhash, I'd like to come to you. What do you think? What happens to the category now? And you also have made some fairness brands in the fairness brand ads in the past. What do you think?
Okay. So I've been hearing everybody's points of view. I think there are four or five different questions we're attempting to answer, all bunched under this whole thing called Fair to Glow, right? And everybody has touched upon different aspects of it. First question, which I think Ram touched upon, is whether the product itself should be legally or ethically sold in this country, which is full of dark people. That is one question, okay? Should the product, basically skin whitening as a category, should that be legally and ethically sold in a country of dark people, right? Now, let me answer that question first. Skin whitening is a very asked for, required consumer need, right? Just as white people in Caucasian countries buy tanning products to become dark, there are enough people who are dark skinned who don't want patches, as Pops put it, or, you know, which is the biggest skin whitening market in the world, Japan.
Mm-hmm.
You'd be surprised. It's about 10 times bigger than the Indian fairness market. Okay. Japan, Korea, and you might wonder, their skin is already so enormously fair. Why is it so big? Because for them, it is not just about dark to fair. It is about blemish-free, patch-free, even-toned glow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. One of the biggest brands in the world in skin whitening is L'Oreal, not even Fair and Lovely. Fair and Lovely is a huge, huge brand, as Ramesh outlined, in India, right? But other places in the world, so skin whitening, the point I'm making, just as Indians would desperately buy SPF products to stop getting darker under the sun, okay, the foreigners are buying tanning products to become darker under the sun. Mm-hmm. Right. So is skin whitening a relevant need? Yes, it is. Is a brand legally allowed to sell skin whitening? I'm sure they are. We don't make the laws of the land. Somebody else does. The government does. The Supreme Court does. So So there is one is on the product, the other is on the marketing of the said product. The how. How do we market this? How do we convince consumers and persuade consumers? This is where I think Fair and Lovely has, in the past, created the biggest conflict in our minds by the whole narrative that you talked about dark skin being sad, dark skin being loser, fair skin being happy, fair skin being winner, etc. So the contexting of that proposition was always against dark skin being bad. It was deriding dark skin while promoting fair skin as a thing. Now, as Runita pointed out, are these all deep-rooted in Indian society? Yes, it is. It is deep-rooted cultural upbringing oriented stuff in our country. The number of ads you will find in fair brides wanted in the newspapers even today is not funny. All right. I'll give you an anecdote from my own personal life. Okay. When I was growing up amongst three brothers, both my brothers were much fairer than me. I was the dark one in the family. You know, jokingly, they used to call me the black sheep. And today I am in BBH, so I guess it was ordained. But, you know, one day I asked my grandmother, I was, I think, about 8 or 9 years old. And I asked my grandmother, why is it that my brothers are fair and I am dark? What have I done? And my grandmom told me something very beautiful. She said, you know, Krishna and Rama were both dark. And I argued with her. I said, no, they are purple. Because in Abba Chetakada comics, they were drawn purple. I said, no, they are purple. She said, no, they were dark. Since that day, I used to mock at my brother saying, you pale faces, I'm Krishna and Rama, dude, I'm dark. You know, I've never had a problem with my dark skin before. So again, it's all about upbringing, yeah? You know, so the way I think in the past, the advertising of Fair and Lovely, especially when it came to dark girl can't get a groom, or dark girl has underplayed in her confidence, and dark girls are this. That was where I think the biggest problem was. The contexting of your fairness proposition in the light of dark being bad. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, Black Lives Matter is a big thing today. But I think the process of change at Unilever started almost 6 years ago. I know it because we were all part of the conversation at ASCII. And Unilever was very much part of it when we actually instituted a policy. Mm-hmm. You can see it on the website. And Unilever has followed that for the last 4 or 5 years. Okay.
2014.
Yeah, 2014. There you go. 6 years. Where you cannot deride black skin in any way, darker skin in any way. And that was a self-regulated policy that we put into place. You cannot show dark people as unhappy. You cannot show dark people as a downer or a lesser in any way. Okay. And in the last 6 years that we have sharply noticed the advertising of Fair and Lovely, thankfully they have stayed on that path. They have not tried to do that, what they used to do in the past, right? So that is one part of it. The second question that you brought out in your introductions, Neeta, is this just a superficial change? Just changing one word and life carries on as normal, right? I don't think it's a superficial change. A close friend of mine wrote an article on LinkedIn recently. He used the term, is it too little, too late? Mm-hmm. And my counter to him was, you know, when it comes to any form of discrimination or bias, whether it's religion or gender or sexual preference or color or caste, any form of discrimination, it is never too late. I'm glad they have done it. Would I have been happier that they have changed their stance 15 years ago? Yes. But am I happy they have done it today? Yes, I am. I think it's a brave move for a brand of the kind of success that Ramesh has just outlined, to change a brand name of one of their most successful brands takes a lot of thinking. Now, whether they've been compelled by social pressures or whether it's their own social consciousness, I don't know, you don't know. But is that change important today? It is. It is important.
Because it's interesting that for years, activists have been screaming about, you know, stopping this product or taking away fairness. And then they finally are compelled to add over a moment which happens like miles and miles away in a country far off.
Whatever it is. If they have decided that it is no longer going to be relevant to follow that same path and we need to change, and we're going to make the biggest change by changing the brand name itself first, I think it's a great first step. Now, secondly, if they only remain just at a brand name change and the narrative remains the same, then it is a superficial change. But I don't think the narrative will remain the same. I think the narrative will change because they have to make it socially relevant for today's and future generation. And they are smart marketers out there. They're not fools. All right. And I think the jury will be out on that. Let's see what they do. Right now, they've just changed the name and just announced the name change. But the communication, the theme around it, around GLOW, will come, and then we can opine whether it's just a superficial change or not a superficial change. That's point number two. Point number three is GLOW itself. The word GLOW that you used is GLOW the new fair, right? Now, GLOW on its own is not a new thing. It's one of the oldest skincare benefits that have been in our country and everywhere in the world for years. Okay, in America, for example, there are skincare creams for Afro-American people that promote GLOW. GLOW is something everybody likes, whether it's dark skin or fair skin, GLOW is GLOW. In India, you have used the word Nikhar for years and years. Vicco Turmeric Vanishing Cream has been doing it in the context of kya roop nikla hai, dulhan ka, for 25, 30 years. GLOW is not wrong. GLOW becomes terrible if you continue to do it in the context of dark is bad. If you take that part of the contexting of the narrative out, anybody would want to have their skin glow and look nice. Nothing wrong with GLOW.
Right, but Subhash, actually so far not really mentioned anything about a change in formulation of the product. Now they're just saying... So technically, it's just old cream in a new, more acceptable bottle. So it's like surrogate advertising, right? Everybody knows Red Label is not selling CDs and they're going to sell alcohol. I'm going to buy that only, right? So how does it change the bias? Ram, I'd like to come to you first. You know, since you said you've been you've grown up hearing this and you were a victim as well. Yeah.
And I have a point to make up to that.
I will also talk about the fact that I'll answer that. I will also go to the talk about what Subhash said. I mean, before that, what Ramesh said was that it is a very valuable brand, and then it means something, and that value means something, and I agree. But then there are a lot of things which can become valuable, and that does not mean that we allow it to continue. For instance, if you sell cocaine legally today, it's a very valuable brand. I mean, all of us have seen that in Narcos, how Colombia became a narco country, and we know that it's got value for it, and it makes a lot of money. The other thing about the legality, yes, there is, if it is legal, if it is allowed, and if there is a market for it, we should let it, we should allow that product to make money, and we should all benefit from it, absolutely in game with that. But the thing about legality is, it's also an evolving concept. Like once upon a time, it was very legal to have slaves. Today it is not. So the definition of legal changes over time. And what makes that change? That change comes because of social conscious people bringing about that change. And that it becomes cultural, and then it becomes legal at some point of time. So my reason for also doing that video was also cultural. I wanted to bring in that cultural change so that it becomes a legal change. I wasn't aware that ASCII had done this 4 years back. It would have saved me the trouble. Had I known that they'd done this in 2014, I wouldn't have made that video and made a lot of enemies in the advertising industry in 2017. So there's a blowback which comes when you do things like that, and I'm aware of it, and I went ahead and made this video despite understanding that. Now, there is the legal side of it, and then there is also the political side to it. What I mean by political side is, when we say political, we only look at India as politics. Okay, we talk about BJP, we talk about Aam Party, we talk about Congress and stuff like that. But there is also a global political narrative which exists. Can you hear me?
Yeah, clearly.
Yeah. So there is also a global political narrative which exists, which is why you see such creams in selling in Japan and Korea, because these were all countries which were which were occupied by the Western world. And there is a very clear Western narrative, which is the white supremacist narrative. And we were all aware of it. Now, that narrative also trickles down all the way, and it becomes a cultural thing in India, because in India, the Westerners ruled us, the British ruled us for a long time, which is why we have this habit of looking up to white people. And it's percolated down over time. And at some point of time, we need to become confident in our skin. I know the pun just fits in very beautifully over here when we say confident in our skin, because this is the time right now when we say, you know, Indians don't need to be underconfident about anything. And we need to stand up and say, this is very, what I am in my skin is good enough. I don't give a damn about your skin color or my skin color. Let's talk about the quality of what we bring to the table, be it like as professionals in whatever field we are in, or like promoting the kind of culture that we are promoting today. So all these reasons, add to this point in time, which is like, you know, changing the name from Fair to Glow. While I also did that film, I didn't follow up with other parts. Like when you say, when we make a piece of communication, you also follow up with other things. You also follow up with other campaigns. So when I said I wanted to shut it down, but I didn't follow up with other things to make sure that it became a higher pressure. I didn't want to build more pressure onto that, because I understand that it also gives livelihood to a lot of people. It's a brand that is giving livelihood. There are a lot of people in that supply chain who depend on it for the money that they make. So it was important to just make the point and walk away for me. And it's good that it's translating into a word change, which is Fair is going and it is becoming Glow. And as Ramesh mentioned earlier, or Subhash mentioned, I forget who, but it was a very valid point, which is the moment the color went from white to pink, the product lost a lot of audience. Then the fact that it is going from Fair to Glow will definitely dent the narrative. Is the narrative important for the brand? Yes, it is very important, because that's the key to the selling of the brand. But as a country, do we need this narrative to change? I believe we do. So we, as Indians, we need to not make sure that narrative shifts from Fair to Glow. And I'm really glad that they're doing this, because Glow can celebrate all kinds of skin tones. And that is what we need
absolutely
in India at this point. And we should actually support this and promote this, because the need to make them understand that it is a mistake. But like I said, once upon a time, it was fairly okay to have slaves. It was celebrate. You'll be celebrated if you have a lot of slaves. And then now it is looked down upon. So the need to make this change is not to be punitive. It is to be supportive, but understanding the economy behind it, understanding the reason behind it, and then make a stand as a country, as individuals that say, in India, I don't think you should be selling white skin. You should be selling brown skin. You should be selling the health. You should be selling the suppleness of the skin. These are things, and we'll very happily support this.
Subhash wants to come in. Yeah.
A point that came to my mind just when Ram was talking was one of the points I couldn't finish, because I think it adds exactly to what he's saying. And that point is about your responsibility as a marketer, right? For years, there has been the axiom that advertising is a mirror of society, isn't it? And therefore, whatever is there in society, advertising will reflect, right? I think the power of advertising has changed over the years. I think it's no longer just a mirror. It can actually influence opinions and minds, right? So from that perspective, I think there's a huge responsibility on marketeers and their creative partners to be able to mold that opinion. So for example, coming back to Glow, if I take Glow today, if I have a Unilever, I would actually create a very inclusive narrative around it. That no matter what your skin type is, you can glow and we'll help you make you glow, right? And that is not discriminatory at all. The same company, for example, has done such a wonderful job on Dove globally by saying campaign for real beauty. No matter who you are, whether you're wrinkled or old or young, you're still beautiful, you know? And I think that is something that I would... Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
And that is, no, I certainly saw a lot of faces frozen. So I was wondering whether it's my Wi-Fi or... Yeah, so I think the issue about how responsible a marketeer you are, because you have the power and the resources to mold public opinion about something, right? And therefore, we all have to be more future-facing. And therefore, if you give me a benefit like Glow, I would look at what is the most relevant context in which I will promote Glow. It is a skincare product. It will give Glow as a benefit. But what is it going to be the most relevant for today's and tomorrow's generation that I can responsibly this thing? So if inclusivity, diversity, acceptance are all part of the new narrative, then I don't think any one of us will have a problem with Glow. As long as Glow doesn't go back to the past of against dark skin. That's my issue.
And that's something one of our viewers wants to add to that. You know, Sharon Ishika says, you know, the drop in the number of people using it when the color changed from white to pink did not really have the advantage of happening at a time when there was high social media penetration. Now, right now, the change of name perhaps will not really change much for the brand. It might actually come up with a different narrative and really it might help it. After all, it's the same brand which has Dove,
like,
right?
Like I said, they are smart marketeers, and if they have made such a bold decision to change the brand name itself, which I think is a significant step,
yes.
Now they have to follow it up with a equally relevant stroke inspiring narrative around the brand. They have Ronita, to make a change from the past.
Ronita, do you agree?
I struggle to be so kind to the brand, quite honestly. I'm struggling to be as kind to the brand as Subhash is being. You know, I have read a lot of quotes and comments in media in the last 2 months from HUL about how the process of change and repositioning had started last year itself, and how the repositioning had started shifting from fairness to glow and radiance in the year 2019 itself, and how those important markers like the cameo of the two faces, the dark and the light face, and the shade card,
right.
You know, the shade card which was there on the pack and every ad, how these have been taken off since last year itself. Now the question to me is, if the intent to shift the positioning was so genuine last year, then why was it only a communication change? You know, because a brand is not just about one element. I mean, you know, I don't need to tell anybody here or in our audience that a brand is really about the entire package of what the product is, the positioning is, the need is, the differentiation is, the packaging, the name, everything. So just shifting one element of that marketing mix, to me, was not sufficient to actually change this whole perception about, you know, about the new positioning direction. Now, if the other important markers, while I understand that an important marker of the shade card had been taken off, then the most important marker is the brand name itself. So if the shift in positioning was so genuine last year in moving away from fairness to glow, then why was the name not changed last year? Why would you stagger it to a year later? You know, in fact, if you want to communicate a new position, it is best to do it as an entire package and wait for a couple of months more. But, you know, bring in the entire package with the whole, you know, packaging change was done, but with the name change. Why did the model in the ad continue to be this fair-skinned person, right? So why was it still glow for a fair-skinned model? You know, why?
Why dark-skin models?
Not of bringing in a bronze-skinned model. Now, the name Fair and Lovely is amongst the most trusted, powerful, and influential brands in India. Generations have grown up with this brand, trusting this brand. Okay, the name is so strongly associated with cues of fairness, that every time you buy the pack, every time you pick up the pack to use Fair and Lovely, every time you see it on the storefront, you are being reminded of fairness as a concept. So to me, the whole shift that started last year was really not a complete step. Yeah, and of course, as Subhash has said, you know, today if the name is going to change, then, you know, it's got to change as an entire package. What does glow mean? Yeah, and a lot of those references have already come up in this discussion. The skin color, Indians are not a light skin, you know, race. We are brown skinned as an average. Celebrate the color of our skin. Celebrate the color of the average person, the skin color of the average person. And, you know, so I think it will be very important for HUL now to really give meaning, complexion, depth to what glow will mean, and do it with complete genuineness and vigor and honesty. I mean, the amount of spend the brand has seen in the last 45 years since its launch, and the amount of marketing might that has gone behind creating fairness as a differentiator and positioning. I am only hoping, and this is really my hope for the sake of, you know, consumers who don't have to see this whole divisive positioning of fairness anymore. I just hope for their sake that the brand and the organization will put as much marketing might and money into this new positioning and, you know, really make that radical shift as it has done for the last, you know, close to half a century. In fact, in, so it's so interesting that, you know, just yesterday, as you know, the mailer about today's discussion, panel discussion, was going around on social media and various groups, you know, WhatsApp groups that you're a part of. One of my classmates, you know, his daughter studies in the University of Berkeley, and at the age of 20, she had written an essay. So she's an Indian student who's now studying over there. And, you know, about the whole trend in the US about moving to bronze color, moving to tanism, and that being the new desired color. Anyways, to me, fundamentally, you know, whether we are talking about light color or tan or bronze or dark, you know, to me, I think the whole narrative just has to move beyond the color of the skin completely.
You know, I'd like to bring in Pops here. You know, Pops, as a creative person, tell us how will the industry rise up to the challenge, you know? Because fairness at the moment is the easiest formula for a beauty brand. That will have to completely change now. Will we see more fair, dark skin models and actually preach something which is relevant and not just, you know, for the sake of it?
There are two things, you know. One, me as an ambassador for gender sensitivity for UNFPA in this country. I really love, you know, whatever Ronita was saying is music to my ears. Second, I also represent an industry. I made my living in this industry. And somewhere, you know, the real India is different. The real India, it will take long time, if not Fair and Lovely. Some other brand will take that, and then you will have the regional brands putting not just three faces, but 20 faces, and then keep selling it in different names. Because the very point which Subhash has made is a consumer need. Who are you to stop the consumers not buying it? Not having a desire to want whatever they want. So as long as people buy it, people will make it and then sell it to them. And you can bring in societal change, but it takes longer time. It took almost, you know, even today, you know, 30, 40 years or 50 years, you know, Hum Do Hamare Do campaign has started. There was no television campaign in that. Only two adults and then one boy and one girl. And then that has literally killed so many baby girls, girl fetuses in this country, because everybody wants an ideal family of a boy and girl. If the first one were to be a boy, you will have an opportunity for the second one to be a girl. If the first one happens to be a girl, the second girl will never be allowed to be born. So there are so many issues. It's a paradox. But, you know, leave all those aside, you know, coming to Fair and Lovely. One, they need to find a positioning. You can't be a goody-goody person all the time. Correct. You need a strong villain. If there is no problem, what are you solving? So, and you know, if people are not tall in this country, you know, all the health rings, you know, what are they promising? Make your children taller. How can they become taller? It should be there in the genes. If father and mother and entire family is 5 foot nothing, they can't have children who are 6 footers. Correct? So people want, you know, the more you dramatize being short, you'll be shamed, and then you will have disadvantages. The more tall will become aspirational. So the more, you know, you show the problems with a scooter, the more cars you will sell. So you have to find a way of finding another demand, if not this, in a legally and socially acceptable way. So that is going to be the biggest challenge for the category. Forget about HUL, 60%, 70% market share. But rest of the 30% will become 70% if they change anything. Because that is how the brand is built, and that is what people want. We don't go and then watch those masala movies, but they make millions of dollars. Because that's what people want, and then people are making it.
I would like to add to this.
This is commercial, this is all money, this is not charity. However, secretly or publicly, I wish, you know, there are more sensitive films, there are more brands, purposeful brands, which can bring in changes in the society. However much you wish There is a reality which you can't escape. Otherwise, it will become a wishful thinking of writing two candles and then forgetting about it the next day morning.
I would like to add to this, and it was a very valid point that Pops made, which is the fact that if these people don't get Fair and Lovely, this narrative exists in 67% of people's minds, the ones who buy this fairness ideology. Now, the brand has this wonderful time where they're changing, and it's and they can do it in the most responsible way. So if your question is if they should do it immediately or if they should take their time to do it, I would go for the fact that you should take your time to do it, because this ideology exists in 67% of the market's mindsets. That's like 67, that's a lot of people in their head. They're hooked on to Fair and Lovely. The moment they're removed, they're weaned away from this, or they're shaken away, jerked out of this, they will go on to the next snakeskin oil guy who's saying, come on, I'll sell you a fairness product. And we have a lot of snakeskin oil guys in our country right now. So to avoid that, you should actually navigate this ideology away from fairness to Glow in a very slow manner, because a dip in their market share will also mean that people are going to other products which are giving them the same ideology. And if the idea is to move away from, take India out of this rut, which is this fairness rubbish which we are stuck in, then it has to be a very organic move. And it shouldn't be like, you know, okay, you said Fair and Lovely, now you're saying Glow, and you're showing fair-skinned people still, we will punish you for it. That shouldn't be the way. We should like actually be thoughtful about it and take it in a very logical manner. So its change is going, it's not overnight. It's like it took a long time to build this narrative into people's heads, which was already an existing narrative which they built. So you'll have to take time to make sure that you take this narrative out of it. We might even like, it might take 10 years or something like that, but it is important that we do it properly and not like, you know, just overnight change and, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure they will take, one second. They might take their own time, because a little change in the brand name is not going to affect the rural market. Yes. There's a lot of people, you know, a lot of markets in India, entire rural market, they cannot read English, they cannot read words.
Yeah.
They see a logo and then identify. I'm sure logo going to remain the almost similar to the Fair and Lovely. That's and then fine. People will see. And then second, the eco effect of that is going to stay. So next 5 years, you know, I'm sure nothing much will change. This is not a stock market, whether it will dip by 1%, 2%. We are talking about mass audience, and then they will go and then buy by habit. And then Fair and Lovely, they will ask, they will get this back, and then still it will be called as Fair and Lovely for next 5 to 7 years.
Yeah.
And after that, it will...
I'd like to bring in Mr. Thomas here. You know, from a business perspective, like he's saying, do you think it makes sense? Because it's about 2,000 crore plus market for Fair and Lovely alone, and 5,000 crore market maybe overall fairness industry. So of course, if I don't sell you fairness, the other brand might. So from a business perspective, how much of sense does it make?
That's what I said at the beginning. But you know, there are a couple of points I want to make, which I've been waiting to make for some time. One is to what Ram said. I began by saying what I'm going to begin with is purely the numbers. And from a numerical standpoint, because there is a need and everyone's spoken about it, because there's a context, it has gained traction. Okay. And I also ended that segment by saying the brand has value. The question is whether it has values. Point number one. The second quick point I want to make is, see, as much as you would like to skirt the issue by talking about how relevant it is and how it removes dark patches and, you know, if we have a need, we must buy it. I'm not sure that anybody in this panel will agree that if there wasn't a context, the one that Subhash referred to, into which you were selling it, and therefore the positioning was around darkness to light, because that's what Indians wanted, that brand wouldn't have had a hope in hell, right? If you had done Glow in 1975 when you first launched it, nobody would have looked at that brand. It is in that context that it gained traction and it became such a valuable brand. And therefore, to Neeta's question, right, if it loses that context, and I said it right at the beginning, the premise on which it was built, you lose an entire market. Please understand that. If tomorrow, in November, Trump starts talking about an inclusive America, he's dead. Okay, yes. That is not his context. His context is a divisive America, right? And that is how it was built. Now, the question is whether that's the right thing to do or not. Even today, the website has talks about dealing with darkness, right? The website in which the product is spoken about talks about fairness problems, talks about something like niacin, which is a melanin retardant. Therefore, it's all, as Ronita said, the product is still very much the product, right? And it is in a context that it is selling. Now, I just want to end with this. And therefore, the whole business issue of the business question which you asked, okay, I know at least two large groups in this country that we have worked with, where the board of governors would have questioned the validity and the ethics of even launching such a product. Okay, are they the only fools in this country? That's up for grabs.
Ronita, you wanted to add something when I interrupted.
You know, we might talk about, yes, Fair and Lovely is 66% of possibly the value market share. I think it's a value market share and not the volume market share. It makes 66%, but you have it's one brand, 66%, and all the other brands are fragmented in that 33%. So it is the unequivocal leader in the category. And it is in that sense the lighthouse and the torchbearer of this category. And you know, the other 33% of the brands cannot ignore what a Fair and Lovely is doing. They just do not have the confidence or the might to stand alone in their positioning if the leader with unequivocal market share position actually makes that shift. And while we may talk about a value market share of 66%, its brand equity or its share of the mind, I'm confident would be much more than a 66%. You know, so consumers may be buying other brands possibly because of reasons of pricing, availability, whatever it is. And to some extent, you know, I'm sure there would be about, 25% who are genuinely preferring the other brand's proposition. But you could have about 9 to 10% who are in their minds Fair and Lovely users, but actually using other brands for other reasons. So its share of mind is far more powerful than that. So quite honestly, I think that Fair and Lovely starts making that genuine shift, you know, in its entire package, then I think the entire category will have to re-question itself. All the other brands will have to re-question itself. And many of the brands actually in that balance 33% are global brands. So you never know if the global pressure in light of the BLM movement will actually come on those global brands too, you know.
How much time do you think this shift should take, Ronita?
I really can't put a timeline to it, but I would say that, you know, I would say 5 years is reasonable.
Five years.
5 years starting from now for the entire category.
I think that's very fair. 5 years is like very fair.
For the category, but I'm saying Fair and Lovely with its kind of might of, you know, money, brain, distribution, everything can actually make that shift much faster and the rest.
I just want to remind people that 55 years after the civil rights movement, you still have a black man who was throttled by a very biased police force.
Yeah. The fact that
I'm not so optimistic about it.
May I say something?
Promotion category. I'm not talking about the entire mindset in 5 years. I'm only talking about this as a you know, commercial category.
Mindset. I'm purely talking about mindset.
Subhash, you wanted to say something.
Yeah. I think whether they take 1 year or 5 years or 7 years is immaterial, okay, to me. Because like people have just said, for consumer or people's mindset to change their bias against dark skin is far more deep-rooted than what one brand can do, all right? That is cultural, that is upbringing, that is far more deep-rooted. As Ramesh just said, dark skin and Black Lives Matter is alive today after so many years, right? It's relevant. So I don't think brands, while they can influence and shape points of view, I don't think one brand can change the cultural context in this country to the extent in 5 years. That will take time, okay? Having said that, I think whether they start the process now, and as Pop said, it may, for the next 5 years, people may continue to refer to it as Fair and Lovely, that time will tell. We don't know, right? You've taken a bold stance to say, I'm going to change my brand name first and I'm going to now talk about glow. and I'm not going to talk about fairness anymore, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of our debate is whether GLOW is just a representation of fair only, and is there a new narrative, right? That's what we have to see. We have to see the new narrative. It can be more responsible. It can be more inclusive. What I do know is that if it is not relevant, they will lose. They have to come up with something that is relevant to the future consumer. And they have to, whether it's inclusivity, diversity, celebration of all skin, I don't know. That we'll see when they come out with it. Right. So, this other point which somebody just touched upon is that why aren't they changing the product formulation? Why only the brand name and the marketing? Right. My point is, if the same product formulation can actually go for another positioning, so be it. Why do they need to change it? So today they are committing to GLOW. Suppose they have to tweak their product formulation to suit GLOW, they should do it. I mean, Pepsi was started as a tonic for dyspepsia. And later on, it was sold as a choice of a new generation, no, youth drink. So it's the same drink that was created, right? Gin and tonic was created against malaria, yeah? All so I'm saying is, I don't think it's about the changing of the product. I think it's about what is mindset. It that you're offering the consumer, okay? And is that relevant? Is that socially acceptable? Is that socially responsible? Then your product deliver on that benefit. If it doesn't, they will lose the market share.
Yeah, we're so short on the time, so I'd just like to take one last question with Pops. Pops, you spoke about how advertising's role is to be aspirational. Also, we have to balance out this, the change. We have to challenge the stereotypes as well. So tell me, how do we move forward from here? Ronita said it might take 5 years to actually bring about a big change there. How, as an advertising industry, creative industry, how do we move from here?
I think Subhash was saying, one brand, one category cannot make a difference. But today, across the world, racism is on an upswing. Everybody is promoting that. And a lot of things, gender is another thing. It all comes out of gender, why you need to be inferior. So that is where the confidence needs to be built. Education is an answer to everything. Today, whether you are residing in a small village or a bigger city, the window to the world is the same, your mobile phone. And that is going to change quite a lot. In 5 years, we are trying to see if a brand can change its positioning and then try and then become synonymous with GLOW. In 5 years, who knows, the societal change might happen. And then you will have the new generation of girls coming out with a lot more confidence, and they might not choose to be what their mothers wear. And then societal change, cultural shift may happen. But going by what history is telling us, societal or cultural changes, cannot happen overnight. It takes generations together, for it to really do that. Changes began, maybe a little late, but last 50 years, more actively last 20 years, changes began. Let's hope that next 20 years, a lot more change will happen than last 20 years. And societal change will actually push people to do that. Even today, it is NGOs' pressure and then the regulatory pressure. It is not the consumer pressure. Consumer wants. They all want. It is the pressure of the other forces, which is pushing people to take a back step rather than the consumer pressure. So for consumers to change, for people to change, it takes a lot more time, and we need to be patient, and whatever way we can contribute to make that change, no change is small, and then we should make that contribution.
Right. Anybody else wants to add something, or can I sum up?
I just want to say one. Okay, Ram, go ahead.
No, go for it, Subhash.
No, it was me.
Ramesh, yes.
Yeah, somebody referred to the fact that the same guys who did Dove. And therefore, okay. So when you juxtapose that with the fact that they've made a bold step, right? Now, Dove has a positioning and a context, has been around for a while. And they've done a great job with that. Okay. I don't want to use the word hypocrisy. It's too strong a word. But they have chosen their battlefields and spoken to those people what they wanted to hear. So this is no bold step, according to me. This is completely the pressure of BLM. And if there was no BLM, I would question whether they would have gone for the change or not.
I would like to add, I was aware that they were planning on adding, like making the change even before the BLM movement came out. The BLM just like became the catalyst.
Catalyzed it.
Yeah, it just became the catalyst to make this change. Considering the fact that they control such a huge part of the market and they have the lion's share of the narrative, they do have the means and the tools to shift the narrative from fair to glow in the fastest manner possible, because this movement is here. The Black Lives Movement just goes to show that it is here. It is here to stay. This voice is going to grow louder. So it is only a matter of time before it becomes, from an ASCII rule, it becomes a law which says, like, you know, you cannot sell fairness in India. And then it will just topple the brand, topple the money it makes. And I think Subhash asked a very important question, like, why is nobody talking about the formulation? The fact is that the formulation does not work. I am your proof for it. I used it for many years. I was supposed to use it. So it does not work. So it is only the narrative that works. And that is what we are trying to change, I guess.
So let's hope the move from fair to glow is not meaningless in the long run and not a case of old formula in a new bottle. And this really becomes a movement to love and respect healthy skin. And, you know, more so our creative agencies can responsibly work towards creating and changing the definition of beauty so that each and every person in the country, even those maybe who felt pressurized to use these fairness creams in the past, can say that it's not only fair that's lovely. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everyone. Ronita.